Late Night Chicago is recorded before a live studio audience.
Nice. Yay, oh, nice. Hey guys. We are on location here at Late Night Chicago at the Museum of Broadcast Communications.
And you've got to join us for this journey. Come with us.
Come on, check it out. There's so many cool stuff around
here.
Yes.
Oh, man, look at this camera.
Nice. Original wow. WGN gear.
All right. She's
Technicolor. I'll get your good side.
Okay.
Oh, I can't. It actually says please do not touch.
Okay,
yeah. Let me honor that. All of our die-hard Svengoolie fans, you have to check out this scene.
Doug and the Grave Tones.
This is pretty cool.
This is pretty amazing. Yes. Who's dressing up as Svengoolie for Halloween? Anybody?
Well, I know I want to suck your blood. No exaggeration, a camera that changed America. This was the first camera to be used to televise our presidential debates. So the first televised presidential debate was between Kennedy and Nixon, and this was the camera that they used.
Pretty amazing.
Pretty amazing. This one doesn't say do not touch, so I'm gonna touch all over.
Oh gosh!
Forty years of fun with Bozo right here. Check it out. It is really cool. Ooh, and check this out. We got the original. This is not a replica. This is an original museum store sign.
Here we are.
We're here on set at the Museum of Broadcasting, Late Night Chicago. Yes. Let's go check it out. Oh, man, it looks good.
Oh, it's real good.
It really looks nice from here. It's shaped up. I'm so pumped. We're going to be able
This is going to be an amazing show.
It is. We're going to speak with Julian Jackson later on, and we're going to have a great show.
Maintenance, please report to the third floor. Our Mason Manna exhibit is on the fritz again.
It's Late Night Chicago with Mason Manna, Roberta Gennaro, special guest Julian Jackson, and a special appearance by Edward Dennis Fogel. And here's your host, Mason Manna.
Hey guys, welcome back to Late Night Chicago. We are on location here at the Museum of Broadcast Communications, right in the heart of downtown Chicago, and we are really, really excited and honored to be here tonight.
Yes, this is a very cool venue, and we are so excited to share it with our viewers. And we have a phenomenal guest with us, the gentleman who runs this museum. Julian Jackson.
Yeah, he's the executive director of the museum here, Broadcast Communications, and has so graciously welcomed us into the space. So thanks so much for having us.
Thanks for coming. It's great to have you and the show here today. It's our honor.
Well, thank you very much. Well, we're going to jump right into it. Let's go ahead and tell the viewers a bit about the museum, what you guys do here, and what your vision is.
All right. Well, the Museum of Broadcast Communication was founded in 1982. In a River North condo, and has moved locations a couple of different times, but its mission has been, up until this point, to preserve and educate people about the history of broadcast media, and that means radio and television. And right now, we have a fabulous temporary exhibit in addition to our permanent collections, which I think we're going to talk about a little bit later.
Yeah, absolutely will.
So I can't wait to tell you all about the museum and the special exhibit we have right now.
Awesome.
I think it's really amazing that there's a venue like this that really is showcasing all the talent over the years that, you know, it's just something you don't want to lose, right? You want to be able to show your children and your grandchildren kind of those shows you grew up watching and experiencing. So it's really amazing, really cool.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and there is a lot of great exhibits, too, giving nods to Chicago classics. Like, we got Bozo the Clown exhibit.
Yes.
Svengoolies, right around, very appropriate for the Halloween season now.
Yeah, absolutely.
So definitely all of our viewers, you want to make sure that you come out and visit the museum. We have a link in the description below that will give you all the information that you need to come out to the museum and have a fun night or night with your family. There you go. And
do anything fun for Halloween here?
We often do. I've told the staff that they can vote on what I'm going to dress up as this year,
okay.
Which I'm going to regret, I'm sure. I'm thinking they'll probably do something SNL themed, but that could mean a whole lot.
Right.
Now, you did mention, so the museum started off in 1982, and I can only imagine all of the changes in the mediums of broadcast communications from the 80s until now.
That's right.
That have undertaken. And so now moving forward, especially with all the influence of the internet and social media, how is that going to impact the museum's presence going forward?
Well, you referenced sort of the changes in the industry that we've seen over the years. And when the museum was founded, there was no repository of historic radio or television quite like the museum's vision. And we have a great archives with historic television shows and radio programs and just about every medium you can possibly imagine, tapes of all shapes and sizes and formats. But the industry has changed a lot since then. Mm-hmm. Back when the museum was in the cultural center, people would come in and there were a bunch of different little carrels where people would be able to check out a tape and view a music performance that they hadn't seen in years or an old television favorite or an old radio program. But now we have YouTube, now we have the internet, and people are able to search up a lot of that information that they weren't able to do during that period of the museum's history. But radio and television continues to have this huge impact on our lives. I mean, who doesn't watch a show or listen to a show?
Right.
And so the museum is evolving to match those needs. And fairly recently, we made the decision, or rather the board made the decision, to make a pretty significant shift. I was brought in to sort of facilitate some of that new strategy. And the staff here is doing amazing work in moving us in that direction. And this fall and next spring, you're going to be able to see a lot of that new strategy come into place.
Well, I'm very excited for that. Definitely stick around to see how that evolves and transpires.
Yes.
You know, we spoke briefly, and you actually, it was really interesting how you were explaining to me just how much broadcast communications really shapes our lives, even without us knowing it.
That's right.
And you have a really cool exhibit that we'll actually show you guys, we'll cut away to it here. That is the original camera of the first televised presidential debate between Nixon and Kennedy.
That's correct.
And if you don't mind, why don't you just tell our viewers that story on how just televising the presidential debate really changed our whole electoral process?
Well, I always hesitate to tell this story with the authority of a historian, which I'm not. But my understanding is that prior to this debate, there had been no televised debates. And Nixon was an accomplished debater. He was very used to the debate format on radio. And at that point, going into this particular debate, he was leading in the polls. But Kennedy looked so good and understood the television medium so well that he looked straight into the camera, he looked tan and handsome, mm-hmm. and Kennedy, you know, was sweating a little bit, he seemed nervous, he didn't know what to do with his hands. I'm sorry, Nixon.
Yeah.
Nixon
didn't know what to do with his hands, kind of like me right now. And after the debate, those who had listened to the debate on the radio thought Nixon had won, but those who had watched on television thought Kennedy had won.
Mm-hmm.
And Kennedy pulled ahead in the polls immediately after that debate. So we have some pretty good evidence here that the medium itself change the course of our history as a country. Mm-hmm. And this is one of these things that is part of this new strategy. We really want to talk about the impact of media on society as a whole. Mm-hmm. And I think we talked a little bit about the idea that right now, everybody is coming to realize the impact that media has on us and our society. Stories about fake news and the trust in the media and these fantastic blockbuster shows. And so media creates subcultures, it creates real information, it creates fake information, mm-hmm. and really tackling that idea of the impact on media on the larger society, I think is going to be a major part of where we go next.
Very cool. Very interesting. You know, I think one of the things when we were going through the museum yesterday that I was really enamored by is just the history.
Yeah.
You know, and the sharing of the history of the programs that we love as children, but also just the whole history of communications and how it evolved. I mean, there are actually exhibits of old, you know, radios yep. and televisions, and one of them, you know, used to be in my grandmother's living room. You know, it was like, yeah. whoa, you know, like a flashback. But I think that it's a really great experience moving through this museum, and I don't think people that have not been here yet understand what's here.
Right. I agree with that, because I think just the preservation yes. of the relics and the yes. artifacts, we don't really have that in this day and age in communication. Everything has been digitized, which is so cool in its own way. But the actual tangible products, to have them in front of you is a really cool experience.
Absolutely. Museums have a couple different missions that they're responsible for. One is that preservation aspect. And so we're taking the artifacts, the physical artifacts, and presenting them. We're taking the media that we have downstairs and beginning the process of digitizing that. And the second part is really telling the stories to the public. So we have the preservation portion and we have the education and storytelling and interpretation portion. Mm-hmm. And there's so many stories embedded in the history of broadcast communications. There's a technology story. There's stories of people. There's stories of the products, the actual television shows and radio shows and things like that. There's stories of the impact that has on society. So there's all sorts of incredible stories that we can be telling here at the museum.
Mm-hmm. And I know definitely you guys are looking to expand your mission and grow the museum. And you recently revamped your internship program. Mm-hmm. I looked online. It's a really great opportunity for any collegiate studies out there or any undergrads out there who are looking to build their repertoire and expand mm-hmm. their resume that are in the communications field. I would definitely check out the Museum of Broadcast Communications website. Look on their website for their internship information, and generally interns will work in cataloging and helping preserve different exhibits.
It is, yeah. Our greatest need for interns right now is in that archival and digitization process. We're going through decades and decades of information and finding out who is starring this particular show, who is the guest on this particular mm-hmm. show. So doing the research behind that, doing the actual digitization is incredibly important, because these are a lot of these are on mediums that decay over time, and so preserving that for future generations is something that we need help doing, and we really want to invite folks into that.
Absolutely. Well, again, be sure the link is in the description below if you're interested at all in interning. You can find the link down below or at the Museum Broadcast Communications website. And without any further ado, I definitely want to jump into the main exhibit of the evening at the museum here. It's actually been going on for quite a while. It's started, when did the SNL exhibit open up?
So Saturday Night Live, The Experience, uh-huh. opened in October of last year,
okay.
and will go through the end of this year, so you still have a chance to come and watch it if you're watching this
yeah.
show in October. And it is a fabulous exhibit. It walks you through the whole process of creating Saturday Night Show, from the initial pitches on Monday, mm-hmm. through the script writing and the table reads and the hair and makeup and costumes, to the rehearsal, and then with a grand finale, you get to see the whole show come together all in time for Saturday night. It's a wonderful experience. You get to see all of your old favorites from all of the years of Saturday Night Live. I think it's 43 years run. But you also get to experience that creation process. And it's a really well put together exhibit. And
who's the gentleman that we met yesterday that actually put that exhibit together? Because
Justin.
Yeah. Right. So Justin did a great job in bringing it in.
Shout out to Justin.
Yeah. Because
he did a great job. And it's a really entertaining and yet educational experience. And like he said, just like Julian said, we get to see the experience of being at that show.
Absolutely. Yeah,
at the end.
And the whole process, you know, it gave me chills when I finally got to see the Saturday night come together.
Exactly.
It's really a lot of fun, especially if you're a fan of the show. Even if you're not, I would definitely recommend coming down and experiencing the Saturday Night Live experience, because it is just such a well put together exhibit. It really is.
Absolutely.
And it's so fun.
Yeah.
And the rest of the museum, it's so worth coming down and checking out.
I agree. Yeah. I agree 100%. So. Julian, your interest in being a part of this museum, where did that come from?
Well, I'm a museum guy, and so the board and the founder were all industry experts. But I'm bringing some museum expertise on how to run a museum, what museums do best, and how to make the visitor experience even better and even deeper. So when I saw this museum in a moment of transition, I thought there's a lot we can do here. There's so many fabulous stories to tell, such a great foundation to build upon.
Right.
I was very excited to be a part of it. And I'm a Chicago native. I grew up here, and I was excited to be a part of preserving the history of Bozo and Svengoolie, well as Saturday Night Live, and all of these shows that I've grown up loving, and wanting to think a little bit deeper about what the industry is like and where we're going next.
Mm-hmm. Well, glad that you're at the helm of it, my friend. It was a pleasure speaking with you today, and thank you again for coming on the show, talking with us, inviting us into your great space.
And make sure you come and visit.
Yeah, make sure you come visit Museum
really
of Broadcast Communications. We're right at State and Kinsey, right at the corner. Again, all the information is in the link in the description below, guys, so be sure you check it out. And stick around, we will be back for an exhilarating episode of Inside the Chicago Actors Studio coming up next, so don't go anywhere. Oh, thank you, man. Welcome to Inside the Chicago Actors Studio, where we go inside the business of show business. I am really, really pumped tonight. We're going to be talking about the importance of training, which every actor really should be training and developing always. And I am sitting down with a really serious, dedicated man to the craft, the artistic director of the Chicago Actors Studio, Mr. Hey there, Admiral. Or is it, actually, it's like Michael Jackson.
Edward Dennis, or you tell me.
Yeah, that's who you are. You're not an Admiral or Michael Jackson.
I fool people all the time.
You fooled me. I was like, wait a minute. I thought we had Edward Dennis tonight. But we do.
Just Edward Dennis Fogel.
Edward Dennis Fogel tonight.
You were talking about the importance of training.
Yeah.
You know, I think the sad part of that, beyond the serious, if there's no, the sad part of all that is that how many actors actually don't respect the fact that they do need training. And you take actors that have already made it in the business, stars, they're training. They're still training. But actors, for some reason, most actors are starting out in the business think they don't. You take, for instance, basketball players. I mean, don't they train and train and train, even though they're still playing the game, and ice skaters or whatever? Mm-hmm. But actors think, well, they have this thing called talent, and they don't understand it. When I got I traveled around. I better take these all out of people who take me serious.
I don't want your creditors calling.
No, I'm going back on it. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, when I started out coming off the stage, I would travel around for a good 15 years, you know, doing concerts and opening acts for, you know, major labels and things like that. So when I got off and I decided to be an actor, I just went into, thought I'm just going to go directly to an agent. So I went directly to Shirley Hamilton. And I said, I'm just going to, you know, go right into the big screen or something. Mm-hmm. And she told me to see a man named Ted Liss. Mm-hmm. And so I figured, well, I'm going to be like other actors. What they usually do is they take their 10-week course or something, and then they're going to be an actor. But I have a lot more respect, you know, for, doesn't seem like it, I know. But I have a lot more respect, you know, for what I do, you know, that I do it well. Mm-hmm. And I learned there's just so much, you know, that goes way beyond talent to learn.
Right.
And it takes a good 20 years to be a completely trained actor, because mm-hmm. you're constantly learning and learning and learning, but it takes you at least 3 years, or, you know, 3.5-4 years to have enough training to have a base,
a foundation
to work from. Yeah, and it doesn't necessarily mean that while you're training during that initial 3 years that you shouldn't go out, because you should. Mm-hmm. You know, going out and doing, like, you know, student films and, you know, all that kind of stuff. I mean, so you can make a bridge in relation to what you're learning in the classroom, mm-hmm. and what is actually going on. And it doesn't hurt you, because they're students,
right?
But when you decide to go into that room with an agent or something, that's a whole different ballgame.
Yep.
And there's so much to learn. I mean, there's so much to learn, for instance, in auditioning, that has nothing to do with how good of an actor you are, that you could lose an audition. Things like what you wear, or you know, how you say your name. How you say your name could determine if they even watch your audition.
Yeah, and your body language.
And your body language and everything, yeah, exactly.
Right. So, yeah, training, because we get people writing in, you know, that they got natural talent, which is all, that's great. But in the professional world, they're going to take a skilled actor every day of the week over anyone who's just quote-unquote talented.
The agents, they look at what kind of training you have,
mm-hmm.
all right, what kind of experience that you have.
Because it also shows that you're serious, and that you have respect for the industry and for the craft.
A trained actor, some people don't know what these tools are. A trained actor will out-act, I mean, no talent. Let's talk about an actor with no talent whatsoever, but has skills, will out-act anyone with just raw mm-hmm. talent.
Right.
All right. They don't understand. Talent is actually a drug on the market.
Right. Yeah.
Training. I'm not just saying because I'm the artistic director at Chicago Actors.
No.
You walk into any agent whatsoever, walk in there and ask them what's the first thing that you should have.
Mm-hmm.
Training.
Right.
And you should be training even between your jobs.
Right.
Constantly honing your skills and keeping yourself sharp. One quick thing, if I can put this out. In my classroom the other day, I was talking about a bite and smile.
Okay.
All right. In other words, a bite and smile would be you eat a candy bar or something like that, and then you turn around and you smile to the camera.
Mm-hmm.
That seems really simple.
Right.
But there's more to it than that.
Right.
Okay, much, much more to it than that. I mean, I sat went to the studio, and I set up a table, and I set up the cornflakes, because I did cornflakes or whatever, and I actually practiced doing that and learned all the different moments that are involved in just doing that. You mean, people think that they look good, you know, whatever, and then they'll get the job.
Right.
Baloney.
Right.
Hogwash.
Yeah.
Rubbish.
There you go, folks. The importance of training is of utmost importance, and I highly suggest if you're in the Chicagoland area, stop by Chicago Actors Studio. You can come and audition for a spot in class here. You can hang out with this guy, Mr. Edward Dennis Fogel, and all of the characters around in our great studio here. We are signing off for tonight. Thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see you again next week for more Inside the Chicago Actors Studio, where we go inside the business of
acting
and show business.
One thing I want to ask you before we go. You think you know your co-host Shannon Baroni?
Yeah. She's a great girl.
I'm trying to kind of like cozy up to her a little bit. You think she would like this? You know, or take her out to dinner?
I think she would definitely appreciate the effort. Don't start with this. Guys, welcome back to Late Night Chicago.
Back.
We had a blast here at the Museum
of
Broadcast Communications.
You got to come and see it.
You
it's really
do.
Something to see.
Make sure you make your way down here.
Again,
all the information is in the links in the description below.
Yeah.
I am thankful I bounced back, a little baby aspirin.
Yeah.
I'm feeling great. It might have been...
I was a little shocked.
I think I just had too many Jardiniere peppers.
That could do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, a little agita, a little...
Yeah.
What do they call it? Reflux?
A little reflux, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. The worst.
Well, Roberta, thanks
yes.
again so much. I had a blast with
you,
as usual.
Yes.
And all of you guys out there, thanks for tuning in. Be
Absolutely.
Sure to stick around for another episode of Late Night Chicago coming your way soon.
Have a great night.
Ciao.
Hello, YouTube! Thanks for watching! Make sure to like this video and leave a comment, then share it with all of your friends, and of course, hit that subscribe button! If you really love us and want to help us keep making great videos, just click that Patreon link. Happy Halloween, everybody!